Okay. Hi. So the first slide here just shows the life cycle of the HIV, immunodeficiency virus, and this is just really to illustrate that the life cycle consists of multiple steps and that these steps are amenable to intervention from various drugs, various medications. So the first thing I want to point out to you is what it means to be HIV positive. Now, to be HIV positive, a patient must have a confirmed blood, urine, or saliva test. An HIV test is no longer just a blood test. It could be urine or saliva. And that this disease stage lasts 7 to 10 years, could be longer. And that the person who's HIV positive can appear completely healthy. And during this disease stage, they can unknowingly infect another individual, because they themselves might be unaware of their diagnosis. And it causes changes in CD4 and viral load that I'll point out later on. One of the most common questions that patients ask when they're HIV infected is, where is the virus in my body? And the short of that story is everywhere we've ever looked. It's present in every component, every compartment of the body, including the intestines, so colon, duodenum, and rectum, lymphocytes in blood, semen, vaginal fluid, bone marrow, skin cells, lymph nodes, in the brain, and in the lung, right? So it's every part of the body we've ever looked. Yes, it's present in different concentrations in different parts of the body, but it is everywhere we've ever looked. So HIV positive as a disease stage is different from AIDS, which is another disease stage. And in this case, there's a positive HIV test and a CD4 count less than 200. Or a positive HIV test and certain infections that I'm going to talk about later. So you can be diagnosed with AIDS and have a CD4 count greater than 200, but you would have to have some other infections that we call opportunistic infections. And this represents a terminal stage of the disease, and you're highly infectious. But in this disease stage, you can also appear completely healthy as well. Can't look at someone and tell whether they have AIDS or if they're HIV positive. So CD4's T cell count refers to the type of cell in the body that HIV infects and destroys, and it tells us how strong the immune system is. Normal levels are between 500 to 1500, and below 200, we say someone has AIDS, and it's also associated with certain diseases when low. Here's a natural history of untreated HIV infection. Remember I said normal is about 500 to 1500, and without treatment, the CD4 gradually falls. Early on, you get some infections called early opportunistic infections, or early OIs. And then later on, when the T cell count is very low, you get something called late OIs. There are various criteria that are used to start therapy, and one of them is CD4 count. And we start medications when the CD4 count is under 350. We follow it constantly while in therapy, and this should increase if therapy is effective. And if you decide not to take your medicines, then the CD4 count is going to head in the opposite direction. So to start therapy, CD4 count is one criteria. And in 2008, it's CD4 count less than 350. Something else that's also used to decide when to start therapy is viral load. And viral load measures the amount of virus that's in the body, normally zero if you're not infected, but could be as high as 1 million. And we start therapy if the viral load is over 100,000 copies per mil. So CD4 count less than 350, or viral load greater than 100,000 are presently two things that are considered in starting medications. When the viral load is under 400, we refer to someone as being undetectable. But the important point here is that undetectable does not mean uninfected. Oftentimes, patients interpret you telling them that they're undetectable as meaning they're no longer infected with the virus. So you have to be very clear that they understand what that means. There are many partners, serodiscordant partners, who became infected even though the index patient was undetectable. So undetectable does not mean uninfected. It does lower the risk of transmission, but it's not zero. So I pointed out that CD4 count tells you how strong the immune system is. But viral load tells you something a little bit different. Viral load sort of suggests how rapidly you're going to progress from one disease stage to the next, from being HIV positive to AIDS. And so uh, Let's say this is death right here, and here's your car racing. You could race there at 100,000 miles an hour, or you could go there at 1,000 miles an hour. Clearly, if your number is this big, you're going to get there faster. So essentially, that's what viral load is saying. The higher the number is, the faster you're going to get to this endpoint. Now, I told you earlier that to be HIV positive, that disease stage can last 7 to 10 years, and that's where most people fall. Here's a typical progressor, and here's a CD4 count over 7 to 10 years. A CD4 count normally is 500 to 1500, but it decreases about 70 to 100 per year. So if you start off at 1,000, you could see within 8 years, you're going to be at 200, roughly. And this is where most people are. But you will meet some people who will say to you, I've been HIV infected for 15 years, and I've never been on medicines. That's because it's these people. Their CD4 count might fall a little, but doesn't go down dramatically so. And their viral load can remain undetectable for years. These people are called non-progressors. There's another category of individuals who, when they become HIV infected, die quickly, within, say, 2 years. These people are called rapid progressors. And you see here where their CD4 count falls dramatically, and their viral load increases astronomically within a very short time. So most people, probably about 80% of people, are typical progressors. Another 10-15% are non-progressors, and probably another 5-10% are rapid progressors. Now this is really important, primary infection. That's the period from initial infection with HIV to complete seroconversion. And two things fall in this category. One is the window period, and one is acute retroviral syndrome. So let's talk about the window period. The window period is a time during which a recently infected person will have a negative HIV test. It could be up to 6 months. It is associated with very high viral load and can be associated with certain symptoms that I'm going to tell you about. But what's key here is that condom use is required and that retesting is necessary. So someone during the window period can have a negative HIV test, a Western blot. Doesn't mean they're not infected with HIV, it's just your ability to detect the infection during that time using an antibody test. It's going to be negative. But the viral load is very high, and so transmission is very high risk. The acute retroviral syndrome is where the ELISA may be negative, requires a high index of suspicion. You may have fever, fatigue, rash, sore throat as the most common symptoms. And duration usually less than 2 weeks, but that's just a range. Some people could have those symptoms for a longer period. And then there's a wide differential diagnosis, which is why it is often missed. So someone with the acute symptoms of the acute retroviral syndrome can present with symptoms suggestive of infectious mononucleosis, secondary syphilis, could appear as acute hepatitis A or B, roseola or the viral exanthems, or toxoplasmosis. So it's a very wide differential diagnosis. So instead of assuming that someone who walks in has infectious mononucleosis, you have to exclude a lot of the other things, including HIV. So here are the symptoms for the acute retroviral syndrome. Pretty extensive. Most people, fever, 80 to 90%, fatigue, 70 to 90%, rash, headache, adenopathy, sore throat, thrombocytopenia, arthralgia, myalgia, night sweats, GI symptoms, aseptic meningitis, oral genital ulcers, or lymphopenia. Does not mean that someone is going to come in to your office or to the hospital and has all of these. Remember that. Someone could come in with just one, with just fevers that they've never had before, unrelenting for 2 weeks. They might come in with oral or genital ulcers, right? Not supposed to be there. Sore throat. But you take the signs, you take the symptoms, and a very good history, a good sexual history, and that will suggest to you that HIV should be a consideration. This is often missed, particularly if this occurs during flu season, right? So here's the rash that can occur during acute retroviral syndrome, maculopapular. Looks very much like what? Secondary syphilis, doesn't it? Looks very much like secondary syphilis. And certainly, if someone comes in with a rash looking like this, you better be thinking of secondary syphilis as well. But don't forget that if you think syphilis, you should also be thinking HIV. Anytime you think of an STD, you make sure you think of HIV along with that. Here's someone who comes in with this cheese-like material on their tongue called thrush. Right, thrush can occur very early during HIV infection, including during the acute retroviral syndrome. And someone might present with just that. Okay. Is that clear? Okay, that sounds like an exam question to me, right? Only you guys know, not the people who are not here, right? Okay. So opportunistic infections occur only when immunosuppressed, increases with decreasing CD4 count, and there are medications that patients can take that will prevent opportunistic infections. But once you get an OI, it increases the chances of death. So the whole goal is to prevent a patient from developing these infections. There are many opportunistic infections that once someone acquires them, gets them a diagnosis of AIDS. And I'm not going to go through the list, but you can see it's very extensive. The worst part is that patients sometimes present with these symptoms, and you probably are not thinking that it's AIDS. Someone might come in with recurrent salmonellosis, you know, get diarrhea all the time, all right, or their blood infection. Someone might come in with tuberculosis, and you're thinking TB. Anyone with tuberculosis should also be tested for HIV. Anyone with any of these symptoms should be tested for HIV as well. Okay. So here's a natural history of HIV infection, and this is where the CD4 count gradually falls. And these are the opportunistic infections. As you can see, some occur very early. So thrush, oral hairy leukoplakia, which we're going to talk about later, tuberculosis, PCP, histoplasmosis, some fungal infections, toxoplasmosis, atypical herpes simplex, and Mycobacterium avium complex disease, or MAC, tends to occur very late. But you see there's an entire spectrum of disease that can occur as your CD4 count falls, called opportunistic infections. So what I'm about to do now is to go through the various CD4 counts and tell you which diseases are kind of expected based on what number the CD4 count is. Doesn't exclude it occurring lower or higher CD4 levels, but most likely it's during those range. So for CD4 counts greater than 500, some infectious symptoms would be acute retroviral syndrome or candida vaginitis. If you have a female, couldn't be a male, if you have a female who comes in with repeated candidal infections, think HIV. Could be diabetes, sure, it could be antibiotics, right? But certainly think of HIV. Other symptoms that occur with an elevated CD4 include a generalized lymphadenopathy, Guillain-Barré, which is ascending paralysis, and vague constitutional symptoms. Some complications that occur with CD4 counts between 200 and 500 include pneumococcal pneumonia, tuberculosis, herpes zoster, Kaposi's sarcoma, oropharyngeal candidiasis or thrush, and some non-infectious signs and symptoms are cervical cancer, lymphoma. Let's take oropharyngeal candidiasis. That is thrush limited to the oropharynx, here and higher. But if the CD4 count is under 100, it can become more extensive, leading to esophagitis. So you get odynophagia, which is pain and swallowing, or chest pain. So someone with AIDS can come in and say, you know, I've never had chest pain before, and I'm 25 years old, 30 years old, and I'm having chest pain. Feels like I'm having a heart attack. Well, usually 30-year-olds don't get heart attack unless it's a family history, right? Or it's peptic ulcer. So you want to consider HIV. Okay? But not just candidiasis that gives you esophagitis. A virus called CMV, cytomegalovirus, can also give esophagitis, and that's usually when the CD4 count is less than 50. Or you could have aphthous ulcers, idiopathic ulceration, when the CD4 count is less than 50. So that's in the differential diagnosis. And that's important to know because the treatment for CMV or candida or idiopathic ulceration are all different, so you have to know which one it is. Here is an example, if you can see it well. Well, more thrush. Candida esophagitis, so someone gets an endoscopy and you're looking right down their throat at this cheese-like material. Okay, so I mentioned oral hairy leukoplakia. This is caused by another virus called Epstein-Barr virus. In this case, no treatment is required. When you look at someone's tongue, what's different between oral hairy leukoplakia and thrush is that you see these corrugations, these markings here along the side, the lateral aspect of the tongue. And thrush can be scraped off without bleeding. This cannot be scraped off without painful and blood. Let's talk about Kaposi sarcoma, which has variable manifestations in HIV, usually cutaneous or oral, but you could have visceral involvement, so in the lungs, the GI tract. And the organism that causes Kaposi sarcoma is human herpes virus 8. This is what it looks like. Okay. Here it is again. And you don't necessarily have to have 100 different lesions. Sometimes a patient could present with just one lesion. Looks like a blood-filled papule. Okay. It could also be present in the lung, as you see here. Not a very good outcome. Okay. So let's talk about complications of the CD4 count under 200. So infectious, PCP, it's a pneumonia. Histoplasmosis or other endemic fungi, miliary TB, which is a TB usually occurs as a cavitary lesion. In miliary TB, it looks like millet seeds, very diffuse on the X-ray. PML, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. And there are also some non-infectious manifestations, so wasting, peripheral neuropathy, where patients will report tingling sensation in the fingers and in the toes, cardiomyopathy, and dementia. So PCP, variable presentations. 20 to 40% in patients not on treatment. So if someone comes in and say, you know, I've been having this dry cough, shortness of breath for the last 2 to 3 weeks, just not feeling myself, consider PCP. Bacterial pneumonia tends to be more acute and high fevers and, you know, more sudden onset. PCP is subacute, big difference. Subacute presentation could be very mild. There's both treatment and prophylaxis for PCP. There are things that you would give to treat, and there are medicines you would give to prevent someone from developing PCP. That's what it looks like on chest X-ray. And this is a silver stain of the organism. Okay. So let's talk about histoplasma, most commonly in the Mississippi River Delta, much rarer in South Carolina. And with this fungi, you have a wide spectrum of illness, from acute pneumonia to cutaneous involvement. Here's an ulcer right here, very painful, but that's also a fungal infection. So not all ulcers are viruses, or right? So consider fungal infection if someone gives a good travel history. Okay, PML. So that stands for progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy. And clinical disease occurs in patients with advanced disease, and onset may be insidious over several weeks. So someone with PML is really very advanced, AIDS. And clinical signs and symptoms include hemiparesis, cognitive defects, speech deficits, visual deficits, sensory deficits, and seizures. And in fact, I'm about to tell you about a lot of opportunistic infections that present with neurologic manifestations. Your job is to distinguish them. The first one is PML, CD4 count extremely low, insidious onset. The clinical hallmark of the disease is a patient with a focal neurological deficit, white matter disease, and no mass effect, and that the lesions do not enhance on imaging. Remember that. PML is also caused by a virus, the JCV virus, a Papova virus. Here's an example of an MRI, white matter lesion. Here is the organism. This is an astrocyte and an oligodendrocyte with an inclusion body. Okay. Let's talk about infections that occur at a CD4 count less than 100. So disseminated herpes, HSV. Most immunocompetent people who develop herpes has it in only one place, right? The genital area. With someone who has HIV with a CD4 count less than 100, It can be all over the body. It could be inside in your organ, particularly your liver, right? Becomes disseminated. A toxoplasmosis is a parasite. Candida esophagitis, you get a bunch of things that can give you parasitic infections that can give you diarrhea. So cryptosporidiosis, microsporidiosis, isospora, and cryptococcal disease. So C. neoformans is an encapsulated yeast that is inhaled into the small airways, which causes subclinical disease. It produces no toxins, and the main virulence factor is a capsule. So the main virulence factor of cryptococcal meningitis is a capsule. Clinical manifestations. It appears like a meningitis, of course. So fever, headache, and a stiff neck. Okay? And the average duration of symptoms is 30 days, which distinguishes that from a bacterial infection. Right? Bacterial meningitis is more sudden onset. But both bacteria and cryptococcal meningitis will present with a fever, headache, and a stiff neck. The predictors of poor outcomes are altered mental status, increased opening pressure, and a white blood cell count less than 20 cells per millimeter cube in the CSF. How do you make the diagnosis? Well, you do it by India ink or cryptococcal serum antigen or CSF, which is about 99% sensitive, or by culture, but most often the lab will do either India ink or serum or CSF cryptococcal antigen. That's what you send off. And remember that the cryptococcal antigen is not indicative of severity of disease or a marker of response to therapy. And it can rule out clinical disease in HIV positive but not negative patients. That's what the organism looks like. Here's another organism that presents with neurologic complications. So we spoke about PML, which is not an organism, it's JC virus. We spoke about cryptococcal meningitis. Here's toxoplasma encephalitis. So it also presents as a focal neurological deficit with seizures, fever, generalized cerebral dysfunction, and neuropsychiatric abnormalities. Remember, not every patient is going to have each and every one of these symptoms, right? Someone might just come in with a focal neurological deficit. Someone might come in with just generalized cerebral dysfunction, you know, confused, all right? Doesn't have to be all of those things, but keep in mind that it's a neurologic manifestation. It says here that presumptive diagnosis is considered confirmed by tissue sample response to toxotherapy in appropriate time frame. It's going to be very tough to get a surgeon to do a biopsy on this. And usually what we do is we start treatment right away. And the patient should respond rapidly. It says here, patients should show clinical response, so neurological deficits, not necessarily fever or headache, by day 5, 50%, by day 7, 70%, and by day 14, 90%. In contrast, if this patient had lymphoma and you started treatment, they wouldn't be getting any better. They would actually be getting worse. So the key with toxoplasmosis is you start treatment immediately and the patient should rapidly progress and get better. Cryptosporidium parvum. Just showing you a picture of some of the organisms that cause diarrhea. This is a cryptosporidial organism. This is Cyclospora, much larger. I think some slides are missing, but. Okay. This is Isospora. This also causes diarrhea. It's acid fast, similar to MTB. Okay. So complications less than 50. So infectious, disseminated CMV retinitis, or disseminated Mycobacterium avium cellulari, and non-infectious CNS lymphoma. So this is when someone is really advanced stage disease, CD4 count less than 50. So disseminated MAC, the vision you have of someone with end-stage AIDS back in the 80s, this is the organism that's responsible for that, right? Someone will come in with fevers, and fevers to 105, 106, 107, very high fever in someone who's just walking around. Right, wasting syndrome, night sweats. Patients will tell you, you know, I have to get up and I have to change my clothes 3, 4, 5 times at night, that the bed sheets are soaking wet. Right, it's a very dramatic presentation. Diarrhea, and not 2 to 3 times a day, we're talking about 20 times a day. Right, pretty profound. And that's the wasting syndrome that you're probably familiar with with someone who has AIDS. The CD4 count is very low, usually less than 50. The organism is also acid fast, and that's a picture of it. Primary CNS lymphoma, another situation where you could have a neurologic presentation. So it's B-cell malignancies that are high grade, occurs in extremely immunocompromised hosts. Common signs include focal neurologic deficits, altered sensorium, seizures, cranial nerve defects. Right, so CNS lymphoma, toxoplasmosis, cryptococcal meningitis, and PML all present with neurologic deficits. Okay, 50% of patients with CNS lymphoma will have a single lesion, usually in the gray matter. Toxoplasmosis, usually multiple, smaller, and associated with the basal ganglia, but the two entities cannot be distinguished by imaging alone. But chances are, if you have a single lesion, it's going to be a CNS lymphoma. All right, and if you're going to have to choose between a CNS lymphoma and a toxo, I take toxo, right? Because toxo you can treat and get rid of and put someone on medicines and they respond. A diagnosis is made based on clinical presentation, neuroimaging, CSF studies, and brain biopsy. CSF PCR for EBV, Epstein-Barr virus, is sensitive and specific, and treatment is radiation plus or minus chemotherapy. A response is related to the stage of disease and control of HIV. Here's an example, an MRI. CMV. So cytomegalovirus is another virus that can cause profound pathology in HIV infection. And here it's looking at someone's eyes, right? And you see this cottage cheese. This is normal fundi, right? Here you see the vessels quite clearly. This is with CMV. So if someone comes to you and say, I'm seeing like floaters, like stars, just floating across my eyes, and I can't see as well as I used to. They could be old, like my age, but probably not. And you look in their fundi, and that's what you see. You get them to an ophthalmologist as fast as possible, all right? Because it could lead to blindness, permanent blindness, all right? And it's associated with a CD4 count less than 50. Okay. So there are various opportunistic infections that we have gone over that for some of them, prevention is recommended. So knowing what the patient's CD4 count is, you should start some prevention medicines. So for PCP, pneumocystis jirovecki pneumonia, it used to be called pneumocystis carinii pneumonia. It's now called pneumocystis jirovecki pneumonia, but people still say PCP. There's prophylaxis for that and standard of care. For toxoplasmosis, for MAC, for strep pneumonia infections, hepatitis A and B and influenza, there's primary prophylaxis available. There's secondary prophylaxis. So primary prophylaxis is the person comes in, never been ill, and you check their CD4 count, and if it's under 200, you start prophylaxis for PCP pneumonia, for example. If it's under 100, you start prophylaxis for MAC, okay? That's an example of primary prophylaxis. The person has never been ill, hasn't acquired the infection as yet. Secondary prophylaxis is different. Secondary prophylaxis is the person has acquired the infection. They got sick. You treat them for the disease, but their CD4 count is still low, so they're still at risk of reacquiring the infection. So you continue preventive medicines. So first you put them on treatment doses. Then once your period for treatment has passed, you continue a maintenance therapy. And so I've listed here some of the organisms for which secondary prophylaxis is standard of care or generally recommended. And here again is a slide that shows OIs for which prevention is not routinely indicated here. I think, you know, for these slides, it's important to know, particularly, well, both the primary and secondary. It's one of those things that the patient has it. You should look it up to make sure whether prophylaxis is indicated or not. I mean, I do this for a living, so I know it, you know, upside down, inside out, right? But just remember that prophylaxis is warranted in many cases. Okay. For PCP, as I pointed out, primary prophylaxis is a CD4 count over 200 for 3 months, then we stop. And secondary is greater than 200 for 3 months, then we stop. If the patient's CD4 count remains under 200, then you continue that prophylaxis forever, indefinitely. Is everyone clear on that? Okay. So CD4 count at 200 for PCP is a stage at which we decide whether to continue or not. Okay. And there it is for Toxo, and for MAC it's 100. Any questions so far? One, two. Yes, you would. So once it's under 200, everything that's under 200, you'd have to prophylax for. So PCP, MAC, toxoplasmosis. For MAC, you wouldn't start it until 100. Once it's over 100 for MAC, you can discontinue. So everything below 200, okay? Good question, thank you.
What was that list again of all the CNS involved?
Toxoplasmosis. Toxoplasmosis, PML, progressive multifocal leukoencephalopathy, lymphoma. Which one am I forgetting? Toxo, cryptococcal meningitis. Okay, they all can present with neurologic findings. Cryptococcal meningitis tend more to be a fever, headache, and a stiff neck, but PML and toxo, you know, or lymphoma can produce as, you know, present as a seizure. Okay. Also, don't forget, this is not a neurologic deficit, but don't forget PCP. PCP can be very subacute pneumonia. Someone will come in saying, oh, I'm just having a cough that doesn't seem to go away. Oh, I feel a little bit tired, right? And if that were you or me, I'd say, you know, get some rest, go home, right? Take something over the counter. For someone who's HIV infected with a T-cell count under 200, you don't want to blow that off because that could be fatal. The next time you see the person, they're in the hospital, intubated. All right? So PCP can be very subacute, shortness of breath, some chest pain, low-grade fever. Treatment is Bactrim. Okay? Very important. Any other questions? Ty? you're sleeping, huh? Okay. So heart. Highly active antiretroviral therapy is a collective name given to the HIV medications that patients are on. Remember that medicines must be taken daily. You take them all or not at all, and missing medicines can cause problems. I'm not going to go over the list of medicines, and you know, you don't have to commit them to memory until you do your ID fellowship. All right? But just know that there are different categories of medicines and that the medicines act at different stages in the life cycle of the virus. There are also guidelines that tell us how to mix these medicines together. You pick from different categories in order to come up with highly active antiretroviral therapy. We've moved over the years from starting medicines early to where we started them later to now where we're swinging back to starting them early. And you can see that there are risks and benefits associated with starting medicines at different times. Long-term toxicity, if you start early, but as the drugs get better, you want to start early, right? So it's a trade-off. You don't have to memorize the drugs or anything like that. Just understand that there are guidelines available that tell you how to combine the drugs together and that there are different categories that act at different parts in the viral life cycle. Okay. When you were born, somewhere in the 80s, when I was fully grown, HIV was a nightmare. It was horrendous. At one point in our history, HIV was the number one cause of death, believe it or not. Higher than unintentional injuries, so accidents, cancer, heart disease, suicide, homicide, liver disease, and stroke. Imagine that HIV was the number one killer. I remember when I started medical school at your stage and going to the hospital in third, fourth year, and patients would just die around you. Patients your age would just die. And we couldn't do anything. It wasn't fun. So we never want to go back to that. Does anyone know what happened here? Why the numbers fell? We learned a lot more, but what did we learn about? What did we develop? I heard it. Antiretroviral therapy. So we started first with AZT, But then we learned that one drug alone wasn't enough. So we gave two drugs, and we learned that two drugs alone wasn't enough. It was in 1996, just about, that we figured out that we need three drugs, now called HART, highly active antiretroviral therapy. Which other disease, you'll get a cookie if you get this right, whoever gets it right. Which other disease do you need a combination of medications to, for it to be effective? So you don't just give one medicine. You have to, I guess I have to bake a lot of cookies this evening. Yes, with tuberculosis, you need a combination treatment. Good for you guys. Okay. All right, so we've moved away from, you know, starting medicines early to starting them later to back whether we should start them early or not. And I put these slides in just to show you that these medicines are chemotherapy. They're very complicated and have a lot of side effects. Glucose disorders, lipid elevations, hyperlactinemia, bone disease. You can get fat accumulation or fat loss. These are not simple meds. These are, you know, pretty toxic meds, particularly over the long term. Here's an example of some of the side effects where someone has, you know, comes in with very sculpted arms, right? They've lost some fat, subcutaneous fat, right? Someone comes with very high cheekbones, right? Here is someone who's 3 months pregnant, right? The only problem, guess what? It's a man, right? Crixivan belly, right? Not very attractive. You could also get something called buffalo hump, where you get fat deposits back here. And it can be very disfiguring, requiring surgery, and can cause back pain, very severe. So the point is the medicines are toxic, they're associated with side effects that needs long-term monitoring. Okay. So because I'm in public health, I figure I would throw in some things about public health. And because you should know. Let's talk about HIV transmission. There is a problem with talking about HIV and the things that HIV is associated with. And I find that a lot of providers, when the patient is a new patient, we tend to bring these topics up a lot. We talk about condom use, risk reduction, illicit drug use, or disclosure of your HIV status to your partners. We do that 72 to 83% of the time with a newly diagnosed patient. Once a patient becomes established, that is, you've been seeing them for greater than 1 year, guess what? We talk about those same topics only 17 to 27% of the time. In other words, we say, you come in the first time I see you, you're married? Yes. How many sex partners do you have? One? Okay. We never ask again. We're assuming that behavior stays constant, right? And someone might have a sex partner, only one, but that was last week, right? You need to figure out how many, and it has to be an ongoing assessment. And 50% of marriages end in divorce. So because someone was married last year or the year before, it doesn't mean that they're not. All right? HIV is found in different concentrations in different parts of the body. And I point out that it's high in blood, serum, body cavity fluids. It's in moderate amount in semen and vaginal fluid. It's found in breast milk, urine, saliva, feces, sweat, and tears. All right, let's see all those who did great in their SATs. Can you breastfeed if you're HIV positive?
Yes.
Okay. Should you breastfeed? Did you guys, the people last year tell you guys the answer? You guys are smart. I did? Okay, you guys are paying attention. All right, urine or golden showers, right? Feces are tossed salad. I forgot I shouldn't say that. Someone wrote me up last time saying I shouldn't say those things in front of ladies. But if you're going to be practicing HIV or anything having to do with sexuality, you have to become familiar with the vernacular that a patient uses. Otherwise, they'll have no idea what you're talking about. All right? So you need to learn the terms. And it's okay not to know, but it's not okay not to want to know. All right? So in certain communities, golden showers and tossed salad. Now, and the reason those pose a threat for HIV infection is that the virus is present in urine, right? We have antibodies, we have at least an HIV test that uses urine, right? For feces, which is oral rectal, right, you can get also salmonella, shigella, hepatitis A as well, co-infections. Less so for sweat and tears as a risk factor. Certainly saliva, bite wounds, associated with HIV transmission. In fact, that's why your dentists now wear goggles, right? Because splash or fluid into the mucous membrane of the eyes can lead to a transmission of HIV. Right? So HIV doesn't necessarily have to be injection, drugs, or just sex. Mucous membrane exposure has been documented associated with HIV infection. And such a person, if you get a call for that, should get post-exposure prophylaxis. So HIV transmission risk, AIDS, because your viral load is extremely high, and STD or genital lesions, because it disrupts the integrity of the membranes, frequency of unprotected sex, circumcision, and viral load, right? So if you have sex with one person in the bar on Friday, chances are you probably won't get HIV, but you could. But if you had sex with everybody in the bar, multiple partners, you're gonna run into someone who has HIV, right? So that's why multiple sex partners is a risk factor. Circumcision has been found last year to be associated with HIV. Turns out that the foreskin has very high numbers of receptors, CD4 receptors, so it presents an exposed surface where the virus can bind and get in. When you are circumcised or had it shortened, then that's all gone. That was a joke, you just missed it. But it removed. We can talk about how that's implicated, right? But circumcision status has been associated with transmission for HIV. We'll talk about it after. That won't be in your exam, just FYI. Okay. So HIV and pregnancy. The vast majority of HIV transmission actually occurs. I know you guys want to hear about circumcision. We'll talk about it after. Move on. Most of the transmission for HIV occurs during labor. So a mom, a woman being pregnant, only 20% of the time the baby gets infected in utero. It's 80% of the time, and that's because when you do your OB rotation, there's a lot of blood and body fluids associated with labor and fetal scalp monitoring and so on. And if the baby survives that process and not get infected, then breastfeeding associated with 14 to 15%. In the old days, about 1 in 3 babies used to be born HIV infected before AZT. But thank goodness, since then, we've decreased the number of babies now to, it's probably less than 1%, because the drugs now are so good. So you want to start HIV medicines if the woman is pregnant in the second trimester. You want to start in the second trimester and continue during labor, as well as give the infant antiretroviral medicines for 6 weeks until you confirm the infant's HIV status. Remember, too, that it's never too late to start HIV medicines, even if the woman presents during labor and has never been on HIV medicines. You want to start HIV medicines during labor and to the infant. Don't ever let the infant leave the hospital without medicines. Something you should also learn is, you know, every survey that they've ever done where they interviewed patients and doctors, everything that we thought was important, the patients didn't think so. Right? You would think that if a patient has HIV, that's the most important consideration for them. They did a survey, and for life priorities of HIV-infected intravenous drug users, only 37% ranked HIV as the most important. Top priorities include housing, money, safety from violence. All right, so we're focused on health, but if someone doesn't have somewhere to live or no food to eat, they're not thinking about their health, so keep that in mind. Remember that success is not just undetectable viral load or abstinence from drug use. Success also includes making it to medical appointments, taking their preventive medicines, so PCP or MAC prophylaxis. Someone might not be able to stop using drugs, but they might be able to reduce the amount of drugs. Someone who smokes a pack of cigarettes a day might smoke half a pack a day or a quarter pack, and that should be encouraged. And that's the last slide. Any questions?